pase. Pierna derecha, directo al arco. ¡Golazo! ¡Golazo!
The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Rollins and Kevin Laramee, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night, and welcome to Soccer Today for Thursday, January 16th, 2020. I'm Kevin Laramee, joined by Duane Rollins, as always, joining us to start the show today from Yahoo Sports, Doug McIntyre, who wrote a great article earlier this week talking about the CBA and some positions of Evan Bush, who is goalkeeper of the Montreal Impact, who addressed a journalist earlier this week on the topic. How are you doing today, Doug?
I'm doing well, Kevin. How are you? Thanks for having me.
It's good to have you on, Doug. Evan, in the scrum to reporters, seemed very positive. Was that, you think, something he was faking for the sake of a good sign for the people, or do you think legitimately these negotiations are going well?
Yeah, it's a really good question, Duane. There's always the possibility of some posturing, in situations like that from both sides. I mean, I think that's normal. But I believe what Evan said, and particularly, I mean, I think if there was posturing on the player's side, it would go the other way. I mean, there would be, you know, he wouldn't have been so optimistic sounding. And the fact that, I mean, this is pretty much what I've been hearing for the last year and a half, that compared to the CBA negotiations in 2010 and 2015, from the very start this time around, and by the way, the players and the Players Association and the league, the owners, have been having preliminary discussions about this CBA going back to, I think, the summer of 2018, if not earlier than that. So this is a conversation that's been going on for a long time, and since then I've heard that the tenor this time around seems a lot different. It seems like there's more respect on both sides. It seems like both sides are in a better place. There's, I believe, an acknowledgement from the owner's side, from management side, that the players are going to get a bit more in this deal than they got last time around. It was really contentious last time around. The players, the hill they were willing to die on was free agency, as limited as that turned out to be. And that, you know, that was characterized as a non-starter by the league, where, you know, you went into that, you know, going into that 2015 season, you really wondered if the season was going to kick off on time, because it seemed like, you know, there was an impasse between the sides. And then, you know, as the deadline, the start of the 2015 season got closer, once we saw the owners budge a little bit on free agency, then that's when it looked like there was going to be a deal struck. And ultimately that's what ended up happening. The players got the age and term, down a bit in terms of what it would take for a guy to, you know, how many years of service in the league, how old they had to be to reach sort of limited free agency when their contracts expire. I'm not sure there's any particular sticking point this time around where it's, you know, there's going to be something that, is a real problem to get through from either side. So, yeah, I mean, I take what Evan said at face value. But he also, you know, you got to say, as optimistic as he sounded, you know, he did qualify his comments and say, you know, we're going to find out more as we get a bit closer to the deadline, and they're still a ways away. I mean, you know, the Impact are one of only five teams that have started training camp. It's only the teams that are involved in the CONCACAF Champions League. The rest of the teams will kick off their training camps later this month. And, the hard and fast deadline is going to be the season opener on February 29th. And, it's easy to be optimistic now, but things get a bit more pressure packed as you go down to the wire there. So the last two CBA negotiations, again, in 2010 and 2015, they came down to the last few days. There wasn't a deal reached until I think it was a week before the season started in 2010, and even less than that 5 years ago. So it's the nature of these negotiations. I think, you know, both sides have the most leverage, you know, kind of approaching that 11th hour. And as much optimism as we heard this week, I would be surprised if it doesn't go close to the wire this time around as well.
You mentioned the hill that they will die on. It was free agency quite clearly, or a form of free agency so much last time. do you have a sense that there's a particular issue that they would so-called die on a hill for?
No, again, and that's my point, Duane. I don't know that there is one this time around. I don't think there is, and it's pretty interesting. I do think we'll see free agency come down again. Again, this is something I've been hearing for years. I think it currently in the CBA that expires at the end of this month, January 31st, it was 8 years of service and 28 years of age. I've been hearing again since way back in 2018 that that's likely to come down to 26 and 6 in this next CBA. I haven't heard anything that would make me think that that's not going to happen. And when you look at, you know, that's always going to be an important issue for the players. But one of the things that I think is really interesting, going back to last summer, you know, when the union started, you know, they started having a meeting with journalists. There was a get-together right the day of the All-Star game in Orlando where the union led by Bob Foose made a presentation with a number of players and talking about some of the things they wanted in the CBA. And I think there's two main things, and the one that we've heard a lot about, funnily enough, to me, Duane and Kevin, is the travel situation. I mean, you've heard guys complain about it. You've heard, you know, big time players like Wayne Rooney weigh in on this. Obviously, Rooney's not in the league anymore, but you know, the league is ready to change the way it travels. I think we're going to see more charters. The players would love to see all teams travel on charter flights all the time. That's what you have in every other major sport in North America. And the owners seem willing to open up the checkbooks and pay for you know, better travel for their players, their teams. But I'm not sure it's going to be every flight, every trip. And right now, I mean, I think it's 4 flights a year, 4 legs, by the way, not even round trips. So we're going to see movement on that. How much, you know, remains to be seen. I'm not sure that's an issue the players would actually be willing to strike over, although we'll see about that. And then the other thing that has gotten less attention, I think, because, you know, the public can understand the travel issue really well. I mean, that's... You know, it doesn't make sense to have an athlete sitting in a coach seat in the middle, and have to connect, and that's the situation. I mean, every time the Montreal Impact go to Columbus, there's no direct flight, so you're either chartering or you're making connections. But the other issue is we've seen these different mechanisms since the last CBA was signed in 2015 to bring players into the league. We've seen the introduction of targeted allocation money and a couple other different mechanisms. I don't want to get into all the acronyms here. Drives me nuts, and I'm sure a lot of other people as well. But I think the players want to see some of those things, if not go away entirely. They want to feel that the players from outside the league aren't getting an advantage, in terms of teams being able to use some of those funds to get some of those players. They believe, and I think rightfully, that the guys that have been in the league and have sort of built this league into what it's become, they shouldn't be subject to a different set of rules than maybe players that are still on the outside. So the players would like to see that go away. They'd like to see whatever the budget is for rosters to be a certain number and not have different players characterized by, you know, whether it's a TAM player or a DP. They want to say, you know, okay, if there's a salary cap, teams can use however, you know, whatever they determine is the ceiling, you know, you can use that money how you see fit. And I'm not sure where that's going to go. Again, I'm not sure that's, you know, it's realistic to see that some of those mechanisms go away entirely. And that's what a negotiation is all about. They'll probably meet somewhere in the middle, but and the players have said consistently a strike is possible. I mean, Evan Bush said, you know, use the word work stoppage when he spoke the other day. It's still it's something the players, you know, are going to reserve the right to be able to do if they don't like the deal they get. But again, that's something that until we get to that 11th hour, we'll really see what both sides are made of.
You mentioned, Doug, earlier that there seemed to be a bit more respect from the owner's side, from the employer side versus the players. Over the last 5 years, money-wise, the leverage of the players have gone up. The salaries have grown a lot, of course, from the last CBA and the one before. Is it a change of mentality regarding to the amount of leverage the owners have and maybe starting a working relationship trying to move it to a working partnership. If we look at the other sports leagues in North America, the NBA is famously treating its players almost better than their own owners, with over 55% of the revenues and profit being shared with the players. And there's a lot more respect towards the players' union or players' association. Is it the beginning of this mentality or ideology in Major League Soccer? And is the players' leverage continuing to grow? Do you see it in the next CBA having them almost an equal leverage that maybe not an NBA, but maybe a National Hockey League player would have? NFL is clearly the worst in how it treats their player, but just wondering, what do you think their leverage is going to continue to go in the next one, maybe?
Such a good question, Kevin. I'm glad you asked it. You know, it's interesting. It's interesting the examples you used. So, you know, obviously the NBA, I think if you asked Major League Soccer players and players from any of the major sports, that's the standard. I mean, players want to have the sort of say that NBA players do. They would love to have those percentages, you know, the majority of revenue, like you pointed out, in that league goes towards the players. You also give the example of the National Hockey League, where it's gone the other direction, where, you know, before the last work stoppage, I can't remember which one it was because there's been so many of them, but at some point it went, the revenue went down from the players getting the majority of it to an even split with the NHL. So it's I believe it's still 50-50. I think at one point the players got about 57% of revenue. So that's gone the other direction. And then you mentioned the NFL, and what do we know about Major League Soccer? Most of the owners, or a lot of the owners that are involved in Major League Soccer, also own NFL teams. So I don't think that, you know, the owners, out of the goodness of their heart, are going to just turn around and give more to the players. You know, that's not going to happen. However, I do think the players have a lot more leverage this time around than they have in years past, and there's a couple of reasons why. There's a sense that the players, and the union hates to hear this, and they will disagree with it, but there's a sense that the players got rolled last time around, that they left stuff on the table. They agreed to a deal. They didn't strike. I think there's still a fear, and I think it could play out this time again, where players, you know, nobody wants to have a work stoppage, but how willing are players to do it? How prepared are they? You know, Bob Foose, the union chief, has talked about, you know, trying to educate players and have a plan and make sure they have money put away if that eventuality comes to pass. But I'm still not sure that the players are ready to take that leap. And the other part of that equation is there's a lot of foreign players in the league that, you know, they might not be used to this sort of thing. It might be their first time ever being part of a players' union that's involved in some of these decisions. And we'll see what their comfort level is in having a strike, especially if it's a long one. I get the sense it's not going to happen as much as the union wants to keep that club in their bag. But the leverage the players have is because, by any reasonable standard, anyone that's looking at Major League Soccer from the outside has seen the growth of the league over the last number of years. I mean, you look just in the last 5 years, you know, 5 years ago, LAFC, Atlanta United were not in this league, and those are, you know, arguably the two flagship teams in Major League Soccer today, along with, you know, you look at a traditional power like the LA Galaxy, who seem poised to make another big splash by luring Chicharito, a deal that's not quite over the line yet from what I understand. But there's two more expansion teams coming in this year in Miami and in Nashville. The league is growing. It's attracting players. It's attracting investors. We just saw Charlotte awarded the 30th team in the league for an expansion fee more than $300 million. And that, you know, significantly more than the teams that came in just before them. I mean, we're talking about, you know, $100 million more. So it's pretty hard for the league to turn around and cry poor and say, you know, we can't afford to give our players some of these things. And the players know that, and they see that. And again, the league, to its credit, seems to understand that they're not going to be able to take as hard a line in this negotiation as they have in years past. It's also the 25th anniversary of the league, so the last thing MLS wants to do is have a labor dispute with their players. I think that gives the players some leverage, leverage they didn't have in 2015. They did have it in 2010 on the eve of a World Cup, when they could have used that leverage. But again, 10 years ago, it's a completely different MLS now. in terms of the size of the league, the profile of it, the money that's been in.
And it appears we've lost Doug.
Oh, well.
Doug, are you there?
Yeah. Lots of good stuff there where we lost him. So,
One thing that I wanted to mention, and hopefully we can get him back in a second. If not, it's all good. It's the disparity in the membership of the MLS Players Association. And I don't think Players Association will, and the players will truly get the entire leverage that they actually have until they find a way to make sure that people, the players, the big superstars, are involved in understanding of the actual process of how Players Association, Players Union actually work. And for me, this is where it might be a contentious point, and they will finally have, we'll have Doug back on the line. Doug, last question before we let you go. We must have lost you here for a second. The Players Union and the Players Association and the true leverage they do have, I feel, will never be attained until the membership entirely, and I mentioned the foreign players that you just talked about, truly get involved. And the disparity in the membership of the Players Association of Major League Soccer is totally different than the other leagues in the world. NFL, NHL, NBA that we talked about, and we can add Major League Baseball to the case, are the pinnacle of their own sports, the biggest league of their own sports, and there's no equivalent in the rest of the world to the same scale. Soccer is totally different. And until players from outside totally buy into the leverage that they can have by being loud and, I would say, very involved in maybe leading this membership of the MLS Players Association, until, I'll just use an example, he's not even in the league anymore, but until a Didi Drogba comes here and is willing to strike to help everybody else, it'll be a contentious point, and the leverage of the MLS Players Association will never truly be utilized.
Yeah, there's no question. And I think the union recognizes that, Kevin. And you look at, I mean, I mentioned Wayne Rooney earlier. He's obviously not in the league anymore. This is a guy that was engaged in the process and certainly, you know, wanted to use whatever influence he had to help the guys on his team that, you know, in a lot of cases are making normal salaries. Like they're earning what teachers and police officers make. I mean, there's still a number of guys on every MLS roster where that's the case. You have young players that are rooming together. I mean, that's the reality of an MLS roster. There's, for all the DPs and the guys that are making millions of dollars, and there's even TAM players that are making really good salaries, there's still a long way to go, particularly for the younger guys. And I think the union's done a good job in reaching out to a lot of the foreign players that, you know, this might be a new experience for them, and educating them. And there is more unity, I think, this time around than you've seen in past negotiations. Evan Bush alluded to that the other day in his comments. That presentation that I mentioned that the union had back in August of last year, right before the All-Star game, Leandro Gonzalez Perez, the Argentine defender from Atlanta United, who's now moved on to Club Tijuana, the Mexican league, he was one of the players involved in that presentation. And you could see how engaged he was. And he made the point that the foreign players, the players that have come into the league from around the world, they are being kept up to speed on what's going on, what the process entails, and why it matters for them to be involved in it. I mean, soccer players are mercenaries. They're gonna their careers are short. They're gonna go where the money's highest. They should do that. They have a very small window to set themselves up for the rest of their lives in a lot of cases. So, I can understand why players would say, hey, this doesn't impact me, but again, I think the union has done deliberately a very good job of reaching out to those players and getting them on board. And I do think that you're going to see a more united front on the players' side than you have in negotiations past, and that can only help their cause this time around.
Doug McIntyre of Yahoo Sports, thank you very much for your time today, Doug. You can follow Doug on Twitter at @ByDougMcIntyre, and you can follow his work on Yahoo Sports. We wish you a great training camp and hopefully a great beginning of the season also, Doug.
Thank you, gents. Appreciate it.
And we'll be right back after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. I'm Kevin Laramee, joined by Duane Rollins, as always. The Two Side Two Soccer podcast is one of the premium podcasts that SPN does produce every week, and it can be found at patreon.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. $2 a month will give you access to the Two Side Two Soccer podcast, where Duane and I talk about Canadian soccer. And this week, one of the topics of the show, Duane, was Ottawa, the Canadian Premier League, and foreign investors. And since that show on Tuesday, and since yesterday's main show of Soccer Today, you and I have worked our sources in Spain. Also, Dan Riccio and other sources out there have confirmed this. It is Atletico Madrid looking into investing in soccer in Ottawa from multiple sources. I can attest to my sources in Spain, so as other places out there. But Atletico Madrid, Atletico Ottawa?
Yeah, that's what I was told this morning, is that that would be the branding. Atletico is trying to increase its international presence in much the same way that UC City Football Group doing so. And that's actually the best comparison. Red Bulls is what you can throw in there. But I think City Football Group's a better one, because in both cases you have teams that in the last decade or so that have emerged in their own leagues as being powerful players in those leagues. Atleti has clearly established itself as the third team in Spain. Manchester City, of course, has, you know, depending on your perspective, the first or the second team in England over the past 5 years, right? But in the same time, they're playing catch up when it comes to their international branding. And Atleti is doing a very similar thing to what City Football Group did a few years before, and this might be part of that. And it all represents a much cheaper investment for them than MLS would, obviously. We just heard the number there, about approximately 30 times cheaper is what it would be.
And if not more, it's crazy.
Yeah, so yes, it would be, that's the play. So it makes sense that they would want their branding on there. Not Athletic, not, you know, anything other than Atleti, because that is their world brand. Whether you like that or not, well, it doesn't really matter. If you're in Ottawa and you don't like it now, you'll get used to it. Right? A lot of people, I don't think anyone associates NYCFC with City Football Group anymore. You know, if you know, yeah. You know, but really isn't, they're not the same at all.
NYC, like New York City, is something that existed before, right? So it's not like the term city for citizen was put in there. So Atletico or Atleti Ottawa would be created to, of course, continue that brand. And if you look at the Atleti Football Group, let's call it like this, you look at Atletico's investment over the years, Atletico San Luis and other clubs similar to what they would invest in Ottawa. And you're right, if you want to start to build your blueprint and your footprint, literally footprint in this case, it's football after all. If you want to enlarge your footprint and you want to dive your portfolio into investment around the world, you don't start with a 400 and 500 million investment. Maybe down the road you will. And even up to today, I don't think City Football Group would buy a Major League Soccer franchise at the price tag of 400 million, which is not what they paid in 2015 or before at all. So I think it's a good example of a bigger soccer brand, a bigger football brand trying to make itself viable outside their own market, because their potential market has been tapped to its probably full potential, but the rest of the world is an untapped market for Atleti. The branding surrounding Atleti, the iconic strip of the white and blue stripes, will probably be seen maybe with some black at some point in Ottawa. But it is a extension of the branding that will be useful to create what we call a pocket of fans for Atleti, maybe in the Ottawa region, even in Canada in general, to increase the amount of viewership for Atleti games, which I mean, Atleti, La Liga, Media Pro, One Soccer, Canadian Premier League, the stretch and the relations in the contact world and the networking, it's not hard to make. But so, yeah, I understand the potential, and I understand Atleti's investment, and especially what I was talking about the other day on this show, the power with their the what they can buy with the dollar, the amount of things they can get with the dollar versus an investment in Major League Soccer, and the amount of control they would have on their investment must be really higher in a CPL format than a $400 million investment for a single entity club, quote unquote, in Major League Soccer.
Yeah, we don't know exactly what how the clubs operate vis-a-vis the league yet, which is unfortunate. Another topic for another day. A couple quick thoughts to finish off this. In terms of the strips, if they go with the Atleti, to me, they are absolutely iconic. Along with Inter, I would put them as my favorite two strips in Europe. I love Atletico Madrid's look. They have a very, they, you know, instantly what you're looking at when you see it. So if you could add a little black to it to make it have some local flair, I think you'd be absolutely having some stuff that would move some, would sell. They'd sell well.
It's easy. Instead of blue shorts, you put black shorts and with the iconic strip, and you got yourself an Atleti kind of look with a little nod to Ottawa and their red and the black.
Yes, and last thought at St. Louis, as you said, they do actually have a couple lone players. I know people ask me this on Twitter, but I'll repeat it here. It is absolutely somewhere where some of the younger players for Atletico Madrid could come. Obviously, there's restrictions on foreigners, but you don't. It doesn't matter where they're coming from, and the league wants them to be younger anyway. So I could absolutely see Atletico parking a bunch of its U20s, U23 players, probably U20 players in Ottawa, and there's nothing wrong with that because you have some high talent guys that be exposed, that the Canadian players would be exposed to and would understand what kind of, you know, with peers their own age, seeing what is needed to get to the next level. And I think that that would be a benefit for everyone involved. So yeah, so fun, kind of funny to think, you know, I've been to Madrid and I've been to Ottawa. They're not very similar cities.
in multiple ways. But no, and it is, again, according to multiple sources, and we can confirm individually, both Dwayne and I, from our own sources, got Atleti as the answer. So is Dan Riccio of Sportsnet 650 and other sources out there. And before we say goodbye for this week, because yes, it is the last Soccer Today of this week. Full disclosure, tomorrow I'm getting work done in my mouth. I won't be able to speak for a few days, so we're going to take tomorrow off. Let's finish the week talking about John Herdman. Canada last night played an international friendly versus Iceland in Irvine, California, and it did not go according to plan. Canada lost 1-0 versus a young, rotated Iceland squad. And Canada, as it's looking right now, unless multiple friendlies are added until March, might not make the hex. Canada might have to go through the repechage. And it's a good point to look at the last 2 years under John Herdman and how he has progressed or not, depending on your opinion on this subject. But Duane put a poll out on Twitter earlier today. We'll get to the poll, but let's analyze John Herdman's tenure, shall we? Looking at the last two big moments that he did have, of course, the win against the United States, no one will ever take that away. But last year's Gold Cup, with the mistakes in the 80 game, of course, and the potential flaws that came out of this, manager flaws, game management, which was one of the mistakes done in this tournament, and looking at Iceland and the failures to make the hex, what do you see looking back at John Herdman's tenure so far as a Canadian men's national team manager, Duane?
Look, disclosure, anyone who's listened to me over the years knows that I am not a blind apologist for John Herdman. I was critical of the hire. I, to this day, think that it was handled poorly, although I think based on external factors that didn't relate to the results, Oz had to go. He was not handling the budget very well. For those that don't know, that's as far as I'm going to say today, but there were other reasons why he was let go, and they were legitimate. However, the hiring process to bring Herdman in made all of that look suspicious. It looked like there was a coup. It looked like there was just people that wanted to put their guy in and push this guy out unfairly. So that was unfortunate. As I've said many, many times before, when John Herdman was the women's national team coach, he is very, very talented at one thing. He's a great communicator. He's a wonderful communicator. He would be a great GM of the national team programs, going out, chasing sponsorships, shaking hands, kissing babies, all that sort of stuff. John would be wonderful at it. Good looking guy, knows how to bat his eyelashes at the right people, right? That's John Herdman. He does it well. Is he a good manager? Well, the women loved him. So he did create a very protective environment for a bunch of young women that they did appreciate it. Obviously, he left them very suddenly, and maybe their opinion of him has changed a little bit since then. But when you look at the absolute results, yes, there were two bronze medals, and it is always very difficult to argue that he didn't do a full job with the Canadian women's national team when you get that thrown back in your face. But as I've said before, the first bronze medal was pure luck. It really was. Bluntly, it was just luck. They got the right draw. They got the right bounces at the right time. Christine Sinclair had a very good tournament. France couldn't hit the broadside of a barn in the bronze medal game, and they got the bronze medal. He deserves more credit for what they did in the second time around. But by and large, overall, bluntly, folks, winning a bronze medal in the Olympics for the women, and I say this with the deepest respect to the women's game, is easier than making the hex on the men's side. And that has to do with the level of competition you're going up against. I'm sorry, but it's just true. So did he deserve this? Is he doing a good job right now? I just don't know. Because when you look at his results, he's won a lot of games. He's 12-4 is his record. But those losses, they're troubling. Yeah. The Haiti loss, as you mentioned, that was comes in a quarterfinal game, up 2-0, didn't adjust in the second half, let Haiti run over them. Suddenly, what seemed like a great opportunity with momentum behind them, like mainstream media started to pick it up. And this is the story of the Canadian men's national team.
Every single time we're on the cusp, we fall out of the glass and end up on the floor.
And you chat every time they have to change the sheets. That they're right on the cusp of breaking through to the mainstream.
And then spillage and change the tablecloth.
Yeah, it's like that scene in Trainspotting, if you know that movie. Anyway, that's every time. And it happened again to a much lesser extent last night, really, right? Like, just as people, it wasn't mainstream this time, but just as the soccer people are starting to go, okay, well, maybe if they beat the Iceland game, and then maybe if El Salvador's team gets switched, and maybe, then maybe they could find their way back to the hex. But then, nope, rug out every time.
Rug pulled.
John Herdman's record against... Sorry, go ahead, Kevin.
I was going to say, rug pulled under your feet. Bye-bye.
Yes. John Herdman's record against teams ranked above him is 1-4 right now. That's something to chew on and think about. Now, I'll let you get your opinion while I look up the poll results. But, you know, I do think it's probably unrealistic that he is under any pressure right now. But the question I ask the listener and I ask you, Kevin, is should he be under a little bit?
Yeah, well, here's the question that Duane actually asked on his Twitter poll that is still open for now. But as of right now, Duane is going to get the results. How safe is John Herdman now that it's clear he's failed to guide the Canadian men's national team to the hex? Four choices were made by Duane. He's untouchable till 2026. Canada's hosting the World Cup with the United States and Mexico. He's safe for the 2022 qualifying, so all the way to the end of the repechage leading up to 2022 in Qatar, he might be safe. He must win the second chance path, or he's on thin ice as of right now. Those were the four choices. And as of right now, Duane, what are the results?
Well, I can tell you that there are 14% of the people out there that hate John Herdman, because he's on thin ice is 14%. I don't actually think that that is reflective of any truth or any belief that these people have. They don't actually think he's on thin ice. They wish he was. That was the lowest answer in this. The second lowest answer was must win the second chance path, the repechage. It's very similar to safe by 2022 qualifying. What I think the distinction there is, well, Lord, I know the distinction is there, is that, you know, they're going to let him do 2022 and then evolve, whereas I think the other option was like he's gone if he doesn't get them through. That's what I would have voted at. If Canada does not win the repechage, he should be fired. I will say at point blank, that is eminently winnable, and they should be winning it with the resources and the player talent that they have at the young level right now. If they do not get to play at least that fourth place game against the Hex fourth place finisher, then... yeah, I don't think there's any justifiable reason to keep John Herdman on board as the manager of the men's national team. I'd be willing to listen if they lose that fourth place game or they lose the Intercontinental playoff, but if they don't get that far, no. Anyway, moving on to the poll. The result that won was that he's safe for 2022 with 45% of the vote. There was 18% of the vote for must win the second place game. And 23% believe that he is untouchable. I might have voted for that, too, because I do think, Kevin, that there is a certain level of halo around John Herdman that doesn't always make sense to those of us that what you know the old adage, the empire with clothes. The empire has no clothes sometimes. That's what I think about John Herdman occasionally.
But also we're not there in the day-to-day behind the scenes to see what he does. And looking at the program since his tenure has started, there's players like Alphonso Davies, Jonathan David, and even Balutabla to a lower extent, who just signed with Montreal yesterday, 2-year contract, officially transferred from RC Barcelona B to the Montreal Impact, that have declared for Canada and the Junior Hollette. And we've seen some great growth with the national team. Is it all on John Herdman? Is it coincidence because of the players that chose to declare? It's all in the same, though. You cannot give one and not the other. You cannot necessarily say, oh, it's a coincidence that Jonathan David and Alphonso Davies, Davies were always going to be, and David also, but a Balu or Junior Hollette a few years ago that chose Canada. Is it Herdman's tenure? Did it help? Is it reaching out to these players? And there's more reaching out doing done right now for young players across in Europe that have dual nationality possibility. So there is work being done, and there's more player being looked at by the national team than before. So maybe there is something, and there's also something looking at the financials of a manager of the national team over the last, not even 10 years. We went from Steven Hart, Benito Floro, Zambrano, Oz, to right now John Herdman. Just a lot of salaries. And at some point, there was 3 salaries on the books at the same time. I do not think the money and the budget will be focused on the manager and the staff heading into what is going to be a busy time for the Canadian Soccer Association organizing 10 games of a World Cup in this country. I don't believe the resources will be allocated solely on managers. So there's something about stability and maybe not focusing on the entire aspect, but how you surround John Herdman. Like you mentioned, maybe finding one assistant that does have a tactical awareness that it could be higher at the international game and in CONCACAF, a knowledge of CONCACAF teams. Maybe that could be really useful and help John Herdman continue to progress, because maybe there's something to it also. If he's a chosen one, well, maybe it's okay. Maybe it's how we surround him also.
And Kevin, quickly, I think that there's an evidence of one of the things that a lot of us had trouble with John Herdman is we thought he might be a bit naive when it comes to the men's qualifying cycle within CONCACAF, that he wouldn't really be able to navigate some of the politics that happens during that. And, you know, politics can sometimes be pretty in your face, right? Like with stuff that happens outside your stadium and outside your hotel and, you know, logistical issues that you're going to have to deal with and just fighting with to get basic stuff that should be assumed but is not in this region, right? And he never had to deal with that with the women, where he would, you know, fly to Houston and play a tournament where you had one hard game. Like, this was different. And I think that there's evidence that maybe that might be true based on his choice. And it was his choice not to play friendlies last year, because his choice not to play friendlies was based on this assumption that CONCACAF was going to do what they said they were going to do. And you never assume CONCACAF is going to do what they say they're going to do.
Don't believe CONCACAF, ever.
Yeah, because they said, oh, we're going to have it based on the CONCACAF ratings. And honestly, John Herdman should have said, I don't know about that. I'm going to try and make sure that I'm in the FIFA rankings, because anyone who understands how the men's game and the politics of the men's game works could have probably seen that coming. Yet he chose to sit back, protect Canada's CONCACAF ranking, which is in the top 6, by the way, because it includes the 3 games that they had pulled away from them that were against non-FIFA teams, which is ridiculous that it does. But nonetheless, he should have known that. He should have seen that coming. And to me, that's an example of how he is being naive when it comes to how this qualifying process works. And at the very least, the idea of going through the repechage, if I want to be half full for a moment, he's going to see that and understand that and learn that at a much lower stakes level to begin with. So by the time he's maybe having to go down there, which would be perhaps in a repechage final against Panama or Haiti, which I think is the likely teams that will be involved in the final round of that, or, you know, the fourth place game against what would be a Honduras or El Salvador-like opponent, or Jamaica perhaps. So maybe he'll learn. And, you know, I've said many times before, the path to the World Cup might not actually be harder through the repechage. It might be easier if a little longer.
the path through the hacks was always going to be difficult, but I felt that the hacks would offer Canada a better chance for growth, which is why I wanted to get them there. But now that it's almost certain, I mean, I was 99% certain it was going through that way before these three games. But with this loss to Iceland, I think any chance that they did some miracle turnaround, which I don't even know how they would do. They'd have to play like 10 games between now and June. But at any rate,
can you create an actual competitive tournament in a month? Be like, okay, here's something we're creating. It's going to happen next month, the Canada Cup. We're going to do a Canada Cup. We're going to invite a bunch of teams. We're going to invite France. We're going to invite a bunch of teams, and we're going to tell them, you leave your good players at home. You bring just your kids, and you let us beat you, and we'll give you money. But it's not legal. You cannot do that. That would be maybe the only miracle way. That's called corruption. You can't do that.
Yeah, no, like, look, now that it's the repechage, like, I can wrap my head around this. And look, I have been for a while, but and see that it probably is going to, like, it will be. Look, that group stage, there's literally no evidence to suggest that they will not win their group. They have never, they don't lose to those teams. They haven't in years. Like, if you look back at the results, the evidence is right there. Canada will win its group going away, because they will be playing the likes of Barbados, which we saw them play last week for the most part. You know, their toughest games might be, like, you know, on the road, they might have, like, a 2-0 game. Like, that will be this as tough as it gets in that round. And then they will get into the knockouts. And I think the first round of the knockouts will probably be pretty easy as well. Once you get to the final, like the semis and the final, it might be a little more complicated, because you could be drawing a Haiti or an El Salvador or a Cuba, which Cuba doesn't seem like they pose much of a pushback. You never know, maybe in Cuba when they actually have players. But they should get through that. They absolutely have to get through that, in my mind. If they don't get through that, they have to can the guy. They have to. You cannot go into 26 where you well have a spot with that kind of failure on your resume. You just simply can't. It would be ridiculous.
Yeah, and we'll see what happens. But as of right now, unless a miracle happens, Canada will not be at the hex. Canada will go through the repechage to try and qualify for 2022. On that note, it's the end of the week here on Soccer Today. Tomorrow, once again, no Soccer Today, as I am getting wisdom taken out of me tomorrow, unfortunately. So maybe on Monday, I'll be back, and maybe I won't be as wise as normal, because I'm getting three wisdom taken out of me yesterday. Actually tomorrow. But on that note, you can follow Duane on social media at 24th Minute, myself at Kev Laramee, and this show at Soccer Today SPN. Thanks to Doug McIntyre of Yahoo Sports for joining us today and shedding some light on the CBA negotiations that are happening right now between Major League Soccer Players Association and Major League Soccer. And we'll be back Monday with a look at the weekend, a look at the news, and a look at the world of football with a soccer perspective. And until then, for Duane Rollins, I'm Kevin Laramee. We wish you a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.